In this video, let us discuss about various process scheduling algorithms. In the previous video, we have seen that the scheduling algorithm or scheduling policy determines when it is time for a process to be removed from the CPU and which ready process should be allocated the CPU next. There are two types of scheduling algorithms, preemptive scheduling and non-preemptive scheduling. In non-preemptive scheduling, once the CPU has been allocated to a process, the process keeps the CPU until it releases the CPU either by termination or by transition to the blocked state. That means the operating system cannot forcefully change the running state of a process. Preemptive scheduling allows low-level scheduler to remove a process from the running state so that the CPU can be given to another process. That means a process can be forcefully taken back from the CPU before its completion and the CPU can be given to another process. Burst time is the amount of time required by a process for executing on CPU. There are several CPU scheduling algorithms. Let us discuss one by one. The simplest scheduling algorithm is first come first served, or FCFS. In FCFS, the process that requests the CPU first is allocated the CPU first. It is a non-preemptive scheduling algorithm. That means once allocated, the process uses the CPU till its termination or till it moves to the blocked state. FCFS policy can be easily implemented using a first-in first-out queue. When a process becomes ready, its PCB is linked to the end of the ready queue. It is allocated to the CPU at the head of the ready queue. Consider the process P0, P1, P2 and P3. The CPU burst time for P0 is 10, P1 is 1, P2 is 2 and P3 is 4 milliseconds. The processes are assumed to have arrived in the order P0, P1, P2 and P3 at time 0. Let us see how the processes are executed using FCFS scheduling. The processes are placed in the ready queue in the order in which they are arrived. P0 has requested the CPU first, so P0 will get the CPU first. After 10 milliseconds, P0 will stop its execution and releases the CPU. Then the CPU is allocated to the next process P1. After 1 millisecond, P1 releases the CPU and P2 will get the CPU. The CPU will be released by P2 after 2 milliseconds and it is allocated to P3. P3 finishes its execution after 4 milliseconds and releases the CPU. That is, the processes are executed in the order in which they request the CPU. Let us draw the Gantt chart to illustrate the schedule. P0 starts its execution at time 0 and finishes at time 10. P1 starts execution at time 10 and finishes at 11. P2 starts the execution at 11 and finishes at 13. P3 starts at 13 and finishes at 17 milliseconds. Let us see the waiting time for each of the process. Waiting time is the time that each process spends in the ready queue waiting for the CPU. P0 arrived at time 0 and starts executing at time 0 itself, so the waiting time is 0. P1 arrived at time 0 but is allocated to CPU at time 10. That means the waiting time for P1 is 10. Similarly, the waiting time for P2 is 11 and P3 is 13. Hence, the average waiting time is 0 plus 10 plus 11 plus 13 by 4 is equal to 8.5. Now, let us see the turnaround time. Turnaround time is the time from submission to completion of the process. In other words, it is the difference between the completion time and the arrival time. P0 arrived at 0 and completed at 10, so the turnaround time is 10. P1 arrived at time 0 and completed at 11, hence the turnaround time is 11. P2 arrived at time 0 and completed at 13. The turnaround time for P2 is 13. P3 arrived at time 0 and completed at time 17. The turnaround time is 17. Hence, the average turnaround time is 10 plus 11 plus 13 plus 17 by 4 is equal to 12.75. Now, let us assume that the processes are arrived in a different order, that is P1, P2, P3 and P0. Let us draw the Gantt chart. P1 starts at 0 and ends at 1. P2 starts at 1 and ends at 3. P3 starts at 3 and ends at 7. P0 starts at 7 and ends at 17. Let us see the waiting time for each of the process. P0 requests the CPU at time 0 and is allocated to CPU at time 7. Hence, the waiting time for P0 is 7. Waiting time for P1 is 0, P2 is 1 and P3 is 3. The average waiting time is 2.75. The burst time has been same for all the processes. However, the average waiting time has been reduced considerably. The turnaround time for P0 is 17, P1 is 1, P2 is 3 and P3 is 7. The average turnaround time is 7. The performance of FCFS scheduling algorithm largely depends on the order of the arrival of the process in the ready queue. Given several processes of different CPU bursts, first time, changing the order of the queue will result in different waiting time for the process. So a good chance is that the process waits too long on an average, especially if the initial processes has got long CPU burst time. Hence the turnaround time is also unpredictable. FCFS scheduling can lead to a situation called convoy effect. If the CPU is allocated to the process with the higher burst time at the front end of the ready queue, then the processes of lower burst time may get blocked for long time. This is called the convoy effect. Next scheduling algorithm is shortest job first. In shortest job first scheduling, the process with the shortest CPU burst time will execute next. It is a non-preemptive scheduling algorithm. Again, consider the same example we have seen earlier. Let us see how the processes are executed using STF algorithm. All the processes are assumed to have arrived at time T0. P1 has the shortest CPU burst time, hence it is placed first in the ready queue. Next shortest one is P2, next is P3, and the last one is P0, which is having the largest burst time. First CPU is allocated to P1. After 1 millisecond, P1 releases CPU and is allocated to P2. After 2 milliseconds, P2 finishes and the CPU is allocated to process 3. After 4 milliseconds, P3 releases CPU and P0 gets the CPU. After 10 milliseconds, P0 releases the CPU. Shortest job scheduling algorithm schedules the process according to the length of the CPU burst time. Let us draw the Gantt chart. P1 starts at time 0 and ends at time 1. P2 starts at time 1 and ends at time 3. P3 starts at time 3 and ends at time 7. P0 starts at 7 and ends at 17 milliseconds. The waiting time for P0 is 7, P1 is 0, P2 is 1 and P3 is 3. Hence the average waiting time is 7 plus 0 plus 1 plus 3 by 4 is equal to 2.75. Turnaround time for P0 is 17, P1 is 1, P2 is 3 and P3 is 7. The average turnaround time is 17 plus 1 plus 3 plus 7 by 4 is equal to 7. STF algorithm is probably optimal as it gives the minimum average time for a given set of process. However, the STF is optimal only when all of the jobs are available at the same time and the CPU burst time are available and accurate. The problem with STF is that it is difficult to know the length of the next CPU burst time. Shortest remaining time first is a preemptive version of the shortest job first scheduling algorithm. In this scheduling, the process with the shortest remaining CPU burst time is allocated to the CPU. Consider the set of processes P0, P1, P2 and P3 arrived at time 0, 1, 2 and 3 respectively. Let us see how the processes are scheduled using the shortest remaining time first. P0 has arrived at time 0 and it is placed in the ready queue. Since P0 is the only process in the ready queue, CPU is allocated to P0. Process P1 has arrived at time 1. P0 has executed only 1 millisecond and the remaining time needed is 9 milliseconds. The burst time for P1 is only 1 millisecond. Since the burst time for P1 is smaller than the remaining time of P0, CPU is forcefully taken away from the P0 and is allocated to P1. Since P0 has not finished its execution, it is placed back in the ready queue. After 2 milliseconds, P2 arrived. Since the burst time of P2 is less than the remaining time of P0, it is placed before P0. P1 has finished its execution and CPU is given to P2. At time 3, P3 arrives and is placed before P0 as its burst time is smaller than that of P0. P2 has one more milliseconds to execute. Since the remaining time of P2 is smaller than the burst time of P3, P2 continues its execution. At time 4, P2 finishes and the CPU is given to P3. At time 8, P3 releases CPU and is given to P0. P0 has 9 milliseconds more to finish. At time 17, P0 finishes and releases the CPU. Let us draw the Gantt chart. P0 starts at time 0. At time 1, P0 is forcefully deallocated and P1 is allocated to CPU. P1 finishes at time 2 and P2 starts at time 2. P1 finishes at time 2. P2 starts at 2 and ends at 4. P3 starts at 4 and ends at 8. P0 resumes execution at 8. The remaining time is 9 milliseconds, so finishes at 17 milliseconds. Let us see the waiting time for each process. In simple terms, waiting time is a completion time minus arrival time minus burst time. That is turnaround time minus burst time. P0, the completion time is 17, burst time is 10 and arrival time is 0. Hence, the waiting time is 17 minus 0 minus 10 equal to 7. The waiting time of P1 is 0, P2 is 0 and P3 is 1. Hence, the average waiting time is 7 plus 0 plus 0 plus 1 by 4 is equal to 2. Turnaround time is the completion time minus arrival time. The turnaround time for P0 is 17, P1 is 1, P2 is 2 and P3 is 5. Hence, the average turnaround time is 17 plus 1 plus 2 plus 5 by 4 is equal to 6.25. Like Unlike SDF, SRTF favors short processes and long processes can be victims of starvation. That is, indefinite blocking of long processes by the arrival of the short processes. Let us discuss the remaining algorithms in the subsequent videos.